Minuto. Hey, Cabo. Welcome. Salamat datang. Ako aba. Yokoso. Alhan bika. My name is Alicia Phillips. I am the Student Center Associate Director on the Portsmouth campus. I greet you in a variety of languages from around the world on behalf of the Tidewater Community College Virtual Student Center. During International Education Week, we have a host of events and activities planned for you, which you will find on our Canvas shell in the Virtual Student Center. International Education Week this year is November the 16th through the 20th, is an opportunity to celebrate the benefits of international education and exchange worldwide. This joint initiative of the U.S. Department of State and the U.S. Department of Education is part of our efforts to promote programs that prepare Americans for global citizenship and attract emerging leaders from abroad to study, learn, exchange experiences to realize, enrich, and uplift our common humanity. Today we have with us Leilani Ligwid, who will talk to us about the Philippines, Dr. Gabriela Toletti, who will talk to us about Uruguay, and Missy Comer from the TCC, from our Tidewater Community College libraries. And she will be sharing information about resources on culture, language, travel, geography, and so on. And finally, we have Rita Cohen, who will be speaking to us about her home country of Ghana and the Tidewater African Cultural Alliance. So without further ado, we would like to turn the floor over to Ms. Leilani Ligwid to share with us about the Philippines.
Hi, good afternoon. Magandang hapon, or in my other language, maayong hapon. My name is Leilani Ligwid, and I am working at the Portsmouth campus as an enrollment analyst and testing center manager. And today I'm going to share with you a little bit about my culture from my perspective. I understand that there are 110 million Filipinos in the world, and I cannot possibly represent them. So I'm going to share with you my perspective of the Philippines. The Philippines has 7,641 islands. My family and I are currently from this island right here in Leyte. And out of the 7,641 islands, 5,000 of them are actually not named internationally. They're only known for their names in either in Visayas, Luzon, or Mindanao Islands. It's native names. Currently, the Philippines have 109 million population, and it's named after King Philip II of Spain. The Philippines is the only Asian nation that is predominantly Christian. 80% is Catholic. My family from the Visayas are Protestants, 8.2%, and we do have Islam, Muslim people close to the Sulu Island, and they're approximately close to the nations, Muslim nations of Malaysia, Indonesia, and other islands right here. So with our languages, because we are an archipelago with 7,000 islands, it reflects our differences in languages. So for every Filipino that you will meet, they're most likely multilingual. Like myself, at home, I speak Cebuano with my family. And if I'm with my Filipino friends, I either speak to them in Tagalog or Filipino. So there are 120 languages spoken in the Philippines, and it's actually an intelligent, you cannot understand one another. So for example, in this screen right here, I'm from this island right here. I got if you notice, we speak in a blue collar, we speak Cebuano. in the border, right next here, is the people are speaking Warai. So even if we're neighbors, for example, if they we don't understand each other because they have different language. So what they do is they have a standardized form of language. So everyone has to speak multiple language. So they use Filipino and English as both official language. So even if we have different languages all over the islands, we still are able to communicate using the national language, which is Filipino or English. So our languages are, this one right here, I'm gonna practice with you. Languages like Tagalog from, that's the national language, so we're gonna use that. It's not my native language, but I do use it with my friends. So this is how you say hello in Tagalog. It's basically the same thing. Hello, how are you? It says, kumusta. So it sounds a lot like Spanish, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And you will know, and I will share with you a lot more information about that, why we sound like Spanish, more so than Asian language. So let's see. I can see everyone. Okay, there you are. So fine. It says mabuti. And then thanks is salamat. So there's a really nice phrase that we use, like greeting. So if you say in a proper, more official and formal, well, what you would say is mabuhay. Or if you're coming, you can say mabuhay as a greeting. And if you're leaving, you can also say mabuhay. Can anyone say it with me? Can everyone try it with me? Mabuhay.
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 Yeah. Mabuhay.
So there's a really fun fact about language learning in the Philippines. So a lot of times you can use syllables, the same syllables, and it would mean something. So what's really fun about it is if you would say ba 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 ba, say ba 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 ba, say it with me.
Ba ba ba
ba ba
ba ba ba ba. What you just said is, are you coming off here? Are you getting off here? In the elevator, for example, or in the bus. And then you would respond, ba ba ba. Say ba ba ba.
Ba ba ba.
So you just told somebody that you're getting off. So there you go. You just spoke my language. That's the Tagalog language. Another thing that you can probably, if you are going to be meeting with a friend, a Filipino friend, I think they would really appreciate something like happy birthday, if it's their birthday. Maligayang kaarawan, or congratulations, binabati kita. Happy New Year, manigong bagong taon. So all of those are in Tagalog. So those are just samples. And I want to show you why we sound so different from all the Asian nations. Again, we are the largest Christian nation out of Asia. We're a little bit different. We look more Spanish. We're more Hispanic, because that's because of our history. So before Spanish occupation, our native peoples don't really have any type of recordings of our history. So it was not later until the Spanish occupation, 1565, or it's recorded in history when Magellan came, a Portuguese explorer came in 1521, when they learned something about the Philippines, or at least we have something in books. And this is so true because right now, even with my native language in Cebuano, I don't see so much with any resources, books, or any type of learning language, or it's hard to learn the language itself because it's not concrete. You know, when you speak English, there's like, you know, this is your noun right here, this is your subject, this is your predicate. But with us, there's not so much resources with our Cebuanan languages because nothing is being recorded. I'm sure it would change now that we have, you know, access, more access to the internet, more resources right now, modern, but we don't really have so much before Spanish occupation. Since, you know, the Philippines was occupied by Spain for 333 years. And then the US came and for 48 years, and then Japanese occupied the Philippines for 3 years. And then we finally got our independence in 1946. And right now the Philippines is currently a republic. So this is right here, a picture of a datu, meaning this is a leader of a tribe in my specific island, in Cebu. This is Magellan right here, and this is Lapu-Lapu. And according to our history books in Filipinos, this is where Magellan died. This is where he met his death when a tribe, when the tribe leader killed him. So if you look at right here, the pre-colonial Philippines, what's really interesting is we look so differently or we dress differently. We look more Austronesian, or we even look like a lot more the Native Americans, if you see. We have in the Visayas Islands, our bodies were heavily adorned with tattoos, and they meant specific things. So these are your traditional Visayan tattoos. But when the colonial era came, they never want us to wear those anymore. So if you notice, a lot of Filipinos don't have those tribal tattoos anymore. It was discouraged. It was looked at as it's basically, it's not modern. And so everything was changed, even through our alphabet. It's not taught our alphabet before pre-colonial Philippines. Nobody's the language anymore. Nobody writes. I mean, there's definitely an interest now with modern Filipinos to learn about the culture, but there's not a book or not a group of people can speak it anymore. So it's very unfortunate because of our history. We don't have so much resources, or we don't know so much about our history. But we looked at our history in perspectives from our colonizers. So we only learn it from them, unfortunately. So this is where our pre-colonial Philippines. And then the next one, we look at the Spanish colonial Philippines. You know, before the Spaniards, our religion is more of like nature. Again, it's like the Native Americans. We worship the sun, we worship the sea, the mountains. And if you listen to a lot of stories about how someone is brought to earth or being born, or it's something has to do with nature. Like, oh, this place right here is, for example, the mountain is some type of like a giant or something. This has nothing to do with Christianity. Even if right now we actually have 80% of Filipinos are very, very strong and devout Catholic. But again, unfortunately, we don't know so much about that. It wasn't until the Spanish colonial Philippines that they wiped out whatever belief we had. And so we had Catholicism became. And then they want us to look less naked, I guess, more modern. So we have adopted their traditions and clothing. And then, of course, after that, with the Japanese period, we also have adapted some of the Japanese. It's only 3 years, but it did have a lot of impact as well in our culture. They had their own. This is an example of the Japanese government. The 10 pesos is that, and but at the same time, it says Japanese government. So it's really interesting. I thought that was really interesting as a sample. Interesting fact about the Japanese period, my grandfather told me that during the wartime, he was stopped by a Japanese soldier. And my grandfather told me that he thought that was his end, but he started singing. He was, put in in a tree. And he started singing, and the Japanese soldier felt bad for him, I think, and he let him go without the other people knowing it. So that was like one of the things that kind of connect me in that era, based on the stories that I heard from my lolo, or what you call it, my grandfather. And then American colonization came for about 50 years. We have the Americans. This is very recent, and because they were trying to help us to get away from the Japanese, we saw a lot of war. We fought, our ancestors fought with them, and with the Americans. And some of them, if you notice, there's a lot of military here. Especially in our Hampton Roads area, there's a lot of military, and there's a connection with that. There's a history because the Filipinos were allowed to work in the military with the U.S. military, and they were promised citizenship. They were able to come here. In fact, I think that's how we got here. We have a military in the family, I believe, and it was more of later on. I'm not very familiar, but I understand that somebody from our family was in the military, and then it was more of like they were able to come in later on. And so this right here, I'm from Leyte, and if you notice, I took this picture. Actually, we are very fond of MacArthur, Douglas MacArthur, because basically he promised that he would come back, and he did come back, and he helped us with the war. And that's why in terms of if you are gonna be in the Philippines, you would hear a lot of very fun, people are very, let's say they look at Americans in a very good way, because we understand that we were helped by Americans. So that's pretty much our history, and that's probably why you can explain in terms of a lot of languages, 120 languages for an archipelago, a very small, like really small country compared to the United States. You know that because it's the island. You know that why we sound a lot like Hispanic, more so than Asian, because of our history. When you talk to a Filipino, when they tell you about history, most likely they tell you from the perspective of the colonizers. We don't have so much information about our own culture. One of my cousins, I talked to him prior to this presentation. He's an archivist in King College, and he talked about, our Visayas Island is actually part of the kingdom in another country, not part of the Philippines. Before that, we were kind of through, like in the Malays. So he told me about that, and I was like, really? I didn't know about that. And again, there are a lot of things that we don't know as a culture before colonization, because we don't have any resources. Now for the fun part, this right here is the one of the beautiful places I've visited in the Philippines. And this is actually, this is a, before this happened, apparently this was underwater. And this is limestone. And so there are like 1,200 of them. And when you see it, if it's not cloudy, and it is brown during the dry season, it looks like chocolate hills because, you know, the grass would be brown. And if during rainy season, then it will be really green and it's really nice to look at. And again, this is where close to my place in the Visayas Island. This one is in Luzon and this is rice terraces. I've never been there yet, but one day maybe I will. But this is one of the ancient Filipinos agriculture system. This is something that happened before any of our colonizers came in. They survived in high altitude and actually adapted this type of system in order for them to have some type of, they can have something to eat. So that's something that I really would like to visit one day. And if you notice, this one right here, you see so many islands. Again, the Philippines has 107 islands. That's what's taught in elementary school. But you, as you can see, some of them are nobody lives them. Nobody lives in them, but some of them, you can have your own island if you wish to. Because there's so many in the Philippines. And you'll feel that you'll own it because there's not many people in there. And this is Mayon Volcano, perfectly cone. And this is somewhere in Luzon. So this is some things that, or places in the Philippines that I love. I'm fond of it. Because it brings a lot of history. So this one right here, they were saying that the reason why this formation was happened was because a lady cried, like a giant lady cried, and these are all her tears. And again, this is not in a book or anything. It's just stories that we heard from our grandparents. And this one right here is another lady that it kind of like just gives life and breathes life to earth. And it's, when it's angry, then it will erupt. So these places have, you know, stories in them. It's not just beautiful places, but I wanted to share so that you can kind of understand my culture, my perspective from my culture.
Leilani, that was so beautiful. And we're already way over time.
Oh, no.
It's gorgeous.
Going to go over a little bit. So I just want to make sure that our attendees are aware that I'm so sorry. But I did not want to stop your presentation because I felt like I was transported to the Philippine Islands. And I really felt good in learning a lot about the indigenous people there, you know, the impact of colonialism and the diversity there, and then just the imagery that we can see through your eyes, Leilani. And so I did not want to stop you, but we really have to be a little bit more conscientious. Yes. So I will not do the Q&A part now. We will save all of the questions for after the presentations when everyone has had the opportunity to present. So I thank you for that beautiful presentation, and I do look forward to engaging you more about it after the presenters have gone. So next, we'd like to invite Dr. Gabriela Toletti to talk to us about Uruguay.
Oh, thank you so much. It's a pleasure being here today. Let me share my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, I'm Dr. Gabriela Cristi Toletti, and I'm Arts and Humanities Chair at the Norfolk Campus, and I'm very happy to be here. What I'm gonna be sharing with you today is my story, my Uruguayan American story. So Well, buenos días y hola. Buenos días y hola a todos ustedes, to all of you. What I will share, as I said, is my own story and some images of my own country. And I will accompany this story also with a tour of artwork that has impacted my life and has molded my existence. So paintings, sculptures, and pictures, all these are wonderful types of artwork. I was born and raised in Montevideo. And here you see some pictures of Montevideo, the capital city of Uruguay. So I was born in Montevideo, the capital city of Uruguay. Montevideo has 1.5 million people and has a beautiful coastline on the Rio de la Plata. It is a cosmopolitan, intellectual, vibrant, and European-style city. Some people have described it as a city with a charm that is at the same time romantic and melancholic. When the Spaniards and Portuguese arrived in the area that nowadays is Uruguay in the 1500s, there were two indigenous tribes called the Charrúas and the Chanás. But unfortunately, these native peoples had almost disappeared by the time of Uruguay's independence in 1825. Yes, they gradually disappeared, mostly as a result of European diseases, constant warfare, and massacres. The Charrúas and Chanás have left, however, a very important cultural heritage that has been and continues to be celebrated in Uruguay through art and literature. Here you see a beautiful monument in honor of our Charrúa heritage entitled Los Últimos Charrúas, the last Charrúas. On a personal note, I'm very proud to say that I have some indigenous blood. I learned this as a result of a DNA test. And as my last name's already revealed, Toletti, my last name from my father's side, and Altieri, that is my mother's maiden name, I also have Italian heritage, 60%. And my DNA test also shows that I also have African, Spanish, Portuguese, Jewish, European, and also British blood. And I am very proud of all these ethnicities. This is actually not uncommon. This is the way that the Uruguayan population is formed, with immigration from so many different parts of the world. So that is what being a Uruguayan is being a little bit of everything. And we are very proud of it. I'm proud of all these ethnicities. So I am indeed a good example of the ethnic diversity that has molded Uruguay into the country it is today. What a unique country. One of our national symbols in Uruguay and also in neighboring Argentina is the symbol of the gauchos. And you see a picture of a painting of a gaucho right there. The gauchos were, of course, it's like the cowboys of South America. And there you see picture of this painting by Juan Manuel de Blanes, that was a very important painter who painted mostly paintings with this topic of the gauchos. And the house that is right there is actually the museum with most of his paintings. Every culture and background represented in the Uruguayan population left a deep mark in the Uruguayan cultural landscape, influencing the nation's visual arts, music, literature, cuisine, and much more. Uruguay is a wonderful country, and Montevideo is indeed my favorite city. So why did I leave Uruguay? Well, first, when I was little, my parents and I traveled a great deal. For example, we lived in Europe for a year. Whenever we had a chance, we went on trips. So traveling is really in my veins. Second, my parents, and especially my mom, instilled in me the importance of learning English. They were worried about the political situation in Uruguay and wanted me to learn English in case I ever had to leave the country. But it is actually not uncommon for Uruguayans to learn other languages in order to get better job opportunities either in Uruguay or abroad. As a little girl, I learned English reluctantly. I was more interested in other subject matters like law and politics. But as I grew a little older, I started to develop my own interest in the English language and in the American culture. I remember my efforts to understand spoken English. I used to go to the school's library called Biblioteca Artigas, Washington, to watch American TV shows. I would watch Peter Jennings' news shows for hours. I could not understand a lot of the words. And I tried to figure out the rest from context. And learning from context is indeed the best way to learn a language. By the time I could understand almost everything Peter Jennings said, I had decided to enroll in a Teacher of English as a Foreign Language program. Right after obtaining my degree, I started teaching English at the Binational Center Alianza Cultural Uruguay Estados Unidos, which is managed by the American Embassy in Uruguay. And at the same time, I was studying psychology at the University of Uruguay. Although I loved and still love Montevideo, there you have some other images of Montevideo, how beautiful it is, my capital city. But I started to develop the idea of studying and living in the United States because I felt I needed to become independent from my parents. My mother did not like my plan, but my father did. He had been in the United States in the 1960s, training here as a Navy pilot and had enjoyed it a great deal. So he supported my efforts to come to the States to pursue a life here, something that he did not do, but he always regretted not doing. Soon, I had my first taste of the United States. I managed, led, and supervised a Montevideo, Uruguay, Minnesota study abroad program. And there is much I could say about that experience, but I'm just gonna say that it was very, very cold because it was in the winter. And I remember saying, this is not human. People shouldn't be living like this. So anyway, my biggest surprise was when one wintry snowy night, my Minneapolis host family invited me to go out for ice cream in a very, very cold day. And in Minnesota, I tried some other American things that I hadn't tried before, like peanut butter, pasta salad, dirty rice, and root beer for the first time. But luckily, not all together. Anyway, as soon as I got back to Uruguay from Minnesota, I was awarded a scholarship to go back to the States, this time for a year, to Allegheny College in Meadville, Pennsylvania. I had already finished my university psychology degree, so I was then both a clinical psychologist and a teacher of English as a foreign language. My mother sensed that I would stay in the States a little longer this time. So she said to me that she hoped that I hadn't learned English because now I was leaving my parents. After a year at Allegheny College in Pennsylvania, I decided to pursue my graduate studies in the States. Wherever I went, I took with me artwork and artifacts from my native land. Here you can see some paintings that are very dear to me. One of a couple dancing tango, Uruguay's and Argentina's most traditional music and dance. I got this painting actually from a street vendor. And the other two are painted by my uncle, Francisco Tamaro, a painter and a jewelry maker. Both of these paintings depict places in Uruguay that are very dear to me. So back to my story. I went to graduate school at the State University of New York at Buffalo. By then I was somewhat used to cold winters, but still the winters got to me. I will never forget the day when I drove to school in the middle of a snowstorm. I somehow got to school and parked, only to find out that my car door wouldn't open because it was frozen. I tried to roll down the also frozen window, not an easy task. Finally, I was able to get out of the car through the window. I made it to class on time, but I was distracted, asking myself, what am I doing here? It is summer in Uruguay, and my parents have a summer house by the beach. Of course, seasons are reversed in the Southern Hemisphere. I could have been enjoying a stress-free summer. But yes, that was true. But it was also true that in freezing Buffalo, I was experiencing a sense of freedom and self-determination that was worth more than sunbathing in the golden sands of Uruguay and swimming in the waters of my beloved Southern Atlantic Ocean. At the State University of New York at Buffalo, I studied Latin American literature and languages. As a topic for my PhD dissertation, I decided to use my psychology background to analyze the works of contemporary Argentine writer Eduardo Pavlovsky. There you see a picture of him and also a picture of my dissertation. Besides being a writer, Pavlovsky was a psychologist, a reporter, a social thinker, and an athlete. Some of his work dealt with the topic of the military dictatorship in Argentina during the time of the Dirty War. I felt that my new area of studies, Latin American literature, coupled with the psychology that I had learned in Uruguay, was a way to establish a bridge between my new life in North America and my previous life in South America. After I attained my PhD, I got my first full-time job in the United States teaching at a small university in North Carolina, and later on at ODU and TCC. When my father learned that I had gotten a job in Norfolk, he was a little bit worried because he had spent a few months in Norfolk in the 60s and remembered a very different Granby Street than we have today. So he said, I do not like Norfolk for you, Gabriela, but I told him that things had changed. I became an American citizen in Norfolk, Virginia. By then, my parents had come to terms with the fact that my life was definitely in the United States, and of course, they missed me way too much. So, did I mention that I am an only child? So my parents moved to the United States. I sponsored them to become permanent residents. So they moved to the United States and brought with them so many more memories, artwork, and precious artifacts that accompany me every single day. My parents and I especially admired artist Carlos Páez Vilaró, who I have featured in this slide and who we had the pleasure to meet. Carlos Páez was a painter and a sculptor, and he even built his house, an atelier called Casa Pueblo, with the concept of it being a living sculpture, which he continued enlarging and to which he continued adding over the years. Casa Pueblo is actually the theme of several of his paintings. I own one of those Casa Pueblo inspired pieces autographed to me by Carlos Páez Vilaró. Nowadays, several pieces of his artwork beautifully adorns my home in Norfolk, Virginia. But I digress. Let's go back to my story. It was somewhat ironic that I had left Uruguay to be independent from my parents, and now I was sponsoring them to become American residents so that they could be close to me. But I had changed. I had found myself, and I could live close to my parents without fearing losing my identity or my freedom. In other words, I had grown up a bit and so had my parents. We had all matured. Imagine that. My parents and I enjoyed many good times in the United States. Although they have now passed, and although I miss them greatly, I know they're still with me in many, many, many ways. Several years ago, a friend of mine said to me, "Remember that you are never alone. You carry with you the genes of thousands of ancestors and perhaps embody many of their characteristics." I have now confirmed that indeed I do. I actually believe that we need to get in contact with our past, we need to get in contact with our past, and we need to heal past wounds so that we can make more valuable contributions to our inherited and adopted nations. I came to the States to find myself, but I did not know that finding myself and struggling for freedom was not as easy as exploring a whole new world. I needed to rebel, but I also needed to eventually come back to my roots. Ironically, I needed to move away from Uruguay to ultimately establish a stronger, more intimate, and more meaningful connection with Uruguay, with my roots and with my family. Nowadays, I go to Uruguay with my American-born husband, Chuck, very often. And every time we go to Uruguay, we develop stronger connections with my motherland and with my husband's adopted nation. Recently, I wrote a book in collaboration with other scholars about the place of Uruguayan writer Dino Armas. The title of the book is On the Scene with Migration and Dictatorship, an interdisciplinary approach to the work of Uruguayan playwright Dino Armas. Writing this book was another way to reconnect with my roots and with my background as a psychologist, as a professor, and as an immigrant. The book was an interdisciplinary project, and I felt that through my book presentations, I took the concept of interdisciplinary to yet another level. I worked with painters, historians, human rights activists, theater critics, actors, musicians, dancers, students, linguists, and professors, including TCC communications professor, Dr. Mark Frederick, and TCC music professor and chair, Mark Dennison. And here you see painter Federico Vega, who painted this piece about the topics of the book during the presentation of my book in Uruguay. It is a great concept to paint during an event as the event serves as an inspiration. And yes, I also myself dabbled in drawing. Here are three of my drawings that I included in my book. I especially enjoyed creating this drawing to illustrate a play by Dino Armas entitled this drawing that I'm showing, that I'm pinpointing here. That was a drawing to illustrate a play by Dino Armas entitled Just Yesterday. With this drawing, I tried to portray the drama of a character named Eduardo, who lives between two worlds, Uruguay and Spain. Eduardo feels an existential vacuum left by experiences of dictatorship and exile. Part of his story has been obliterated. In fact, he says, I lost my history. I lost my story. They stole it from me. They erased it. So that empty space that you see here in this drawing, that empty space in the middle of my drawing symbolizes that part of his story, which he feels has been erased. Eduardo's drama is the drama of so many immigrants of today and of yesterday and of all times. Let's see. In this slide, I include pictures of the presentation of the Spanish language edition of my book in 2017. In this slide, I include pictures of the English language edition presentation of my book in Norfolk at the Roper Theater in 2018. I'd like to add that my husband, Chuck, was an integral part of both presentations and of the production of the book. So let's see,
Lady, Dr. Will you be able to stay with us until the end of the program? Yes, I know you weren't feeling well. Yes.
And I'm really almost finished. So that is my story. And thank you so much for listening to me today.
Thank you so much for sharing your story, Dr. Toletti. In just those two presentations, we've seen so many common themes. And so we are only halfway through the presentation and we're almost at time. So I want to make sure that we move quickly into the next segment with Missy Comer from the TCC, Tidewater Community College Libraries. Uh-oh. Missy, can you hear us? You're muted, honey.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay. Yeah. So as Alicia mentioned, my name is Missy. I'm a librarian here at Tidewater Community College. I'm at the Portsmouth campus. Today, we're going to take a look at some library resources related to international interest. Okay. Okay, looking to learn a new language, the library has books, ebooks, audiobooks, and periodicals that can help you meet that goal. We also have resources that can enrich your knowledge of millions of the wonderful ways others live. When doing a search of the library's catalog, try different search terms such as geography of France, German language, or world religions. Here you can see one of our Spanish audio CDs. Among our databases, we have those that stream international films or shorter, more targeted educational videos. For example, Canopy has a category entitled Popular World Cinema, which includes titles in French, Spanish, German, Middle Eastern, Italian, Japanese, Chinese, African, Nordic, and Korean. You can also find resources on international literature, such as our example here of early Korean literature, as well as art that is specific to one country, like our example of a guide to Mexican art. Here's an example of what a title, if you go into the Canopy database, this is what it will look like. A lot of us are getting ready to celebrate the American tradition of Thanksgiving. Why not put an international spin on it and try a recipe from the many world cuisine cookbooks you can borrow from the library? Here's an East African banana jam recipe from the African Kitchen Cookbook. There are many resources available from the library that relate to international interests, but one of the best for a quick overview is the World Factbook database. The World Factbook has over 267 world entities and includes history, people, government, economy, geography, communication, transportation, military, transnational issues, world maps, and flags, just about anything you would want to know about a country, and it's a great source for finding statistics. And just because librarians love passing on information, here are two free, fun online resources. Of course, everybody's heard or has already used YouTube, but you can also use it, for example, to take a night walk along Osaka, Japan, train trip through Mexico, or view a drone that is flying through Africa. The other one is EarthCam. EarthCam is the leading network of live streaming webcams for tourism and entertainment. And you can see they have a Dublin cam on a pub, and you can actually see the camera on the inside of the pub as well. Or you can take a look at the Western Wall in Jerusalem, Israel, or view a volcano from Costa Rica. Take some time, look around at all the unique and interesting videos that they have to offer. And before I go, I just want to make sure that you know how to use the library tools to access our resources. As you can see, that quick search tool right here, that is where you would enter your search terms in order to search the library's catalog. If you're working on an assignment, you want to go with the research step-by-step, that's a great place to begin. Our How Do I section gives you the basic steps for such things as searching for an ebook or video or borrowing from another library. And if you're a faculty member, the library can help you locate open educational resources. For example, many of the photos that I use were OER resources. And as always, if you have any questions, you can see this Ask a Librarian option on the library website, and you can click that and get a librarian 24/7. The libraries are open to current students. Please follow our COVID guidelines, which are also located on the library's homepage. Thank you for allowing the library to be a part of International Education Week, and we hope you have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you so much, Missy. We appreciate you being here with us today and, of course, sharing the vast variety of resources that are available to our students here at Tidewater Community College and the libraries, so we can be learning about the world even while we're here. And finally, we have Rita Cohen, who's representing Ghana and Tidewater African Cultural Alliance.
Good afternoon, everybody. While I'm getting my screen sharing set up, actually, it's ready. Let me go ahead and get this enlarged. Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to play this video for you and then I will continue. It's short. About 50 years ago. No, I'm just kidding. So this little girl is dancing one of the very well-known dances of Ghana called Adowa by the Akan people. And I'll get more into that as I go into my presentation. But I wanted to begin that with you because anytime you go to an event in Ghana, it will almost always begin with dance. And I just wanted to share that with you. So again, I am Rita Adiko Cohen. There we go. Okay, so Akwaaba, which means welcome to Ghana. It is tree, which is part of the Akan people where that dance Adowa, which by the way means antelope, comes from. The whole word is actually a combination of a few words. Ako, which means he or she has gone. Aba, which means he or she has returned to create Akwaaba. So if somebody has gone and returned someplace, you welcome them back. So I am the founder and executive director of the Tidewater African Cultural Alliance, an organization, a nonprofit organization that exists to bring Africans and others together through community outreach, community service, and cultural arts and events. And we actually had a great event on Saturday and we'll be having more. So you can check out our website, which I will share later to see what we do. So back to Ghana. I and my mother and sister came and joined my father in, I'll go ahead and say it, October 1982, when he was living in Norfolk. He was supposed to have been here for maybe a year. He was sponsored by an African-American family that traveled to Ghana and just fell in love with him and his spirit. So, excuse me, they sponsored him to come here and he was supposed to be here maybe a year, at most 3 years, to prepare for us to come. Well, it took almost 8 years. And it was not until I was 13 months old that he came here. So let us continue. As I told you, my name, my first name, Rita, is from the Bible. And that's a typical way, at least my generation, that children in Ghana were and are named. My middle name, Koko, signifies that I am the second born daughter on my father's side. Excuse me. Adiko is my maiden name, and Cohen is my married name. So generally everybody in Ghana, and I will go ahead to even say in Africa, their name has a special meaning. Okay, so this is the country of Ghana. As you see, it is in West Africa, right here, situated between Togo to the east, Côte d'Ivoire to the west, Burkina Faso to the north. Now, if you notice, it's encased between Francophone countries. At that point, we're the only English-speaking country. This is the map of Ghana, and we have 16 different departments, and each one has its own specific language, depending on the area. So I had mentioned Tri or Akan, and it is this area that speaks it. I was born in Accra. So my people are based on, in the Ga ethnicity. And my father is Gadangbe, and my mother is Ewe. And those people are typically from Togo, but interestingly enough, historically, they're from Ethiopia. So there's a whole thing there. But anyway, excuse me. Let's go ahead and compare. Now, if you see, let me go back to Ghana. This is the size of Ghana. Look at the population, over 30 million people. It is the same size as the US state of Oregon, which has 4.28 million people. So you can imagine how overcrowded it is, especially in the southern part where 54% of the population lives. Let me show you some famous Ghanaians. We have, and this lady has my heart forever. Her name is Ohenema, which means Queen Mother, Ya Asantewaa. She was born on October 17, 1840, and died on October 17, 1921. In my country and in my culture, there is a belief. We believe that if you are born and die on the same day, that is it. Your life cycle has ended. You will not be reincarnated. So it appears that she has done so much good in all her different lives that this was her last one. And boy, was it amazing. She alone incited what is called the Ya Asantewaa Wars or the Golden Stool Wars. There was a British soldier which came to her village in Kumasi, the Akan capital. And he sat on the golden stool, the throne of the king, her son. She was so infuriated because that stool is specifically meant only for the king. And the reason why is because the people believe that it was sent from heaven. And so only a person from heaven designated by the rest of the people, by tribal leaders, is supposed to sit on there. So the British soldier sat on there and he refused to get up. Well, she was angry. She went and got her gun, challenged all the men in the village to declare war. They would not. So she did it herself. She went and grabbed all the women and children in the village and fought a war for almost 1 year before she was defeated. Eventually the men joined, but it was primarily women and children who initiated this war. So we also have Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Ghana. Ghana was also the first sub-Saharan country to be liberated from colonial British rule in 1957. And fun fact, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was there for the inaugural celebration in Accra. And then we have Kofi Annan, the first African-American or African, Black African Secretary General of the United Nations. He also won a Nobel Peace Prize. So Ghana, the word Ghana means warrior king. And Ghana is known for gold. It used to be called the Gold Coast. And cacao or cocoa, this is actually what it looks like on the tree. This is the fruit, it is so delicious. And then the seeds are fermented and dried and then ground into what you know as cocoa or cocoa powder, chocolate. Now, interestingly enough, Ghana is the number two producing cacao nation in the world. To the west, I had shown you earlier, what is Cote d'Ivoire, which is number one. The two of them are now engaged in what's called the cocoa cartel because they refuse to export their product unless they can get the same amount or the same pricing that other countries get and for which it is sold. For example, Belgium uses Ghanaian chocolate a lot, will pay the cheapest price to get it, and as you know, will ask for exorbitant prices for their product. So they refuse to sell unless they can get equal fair trade. And we were recently in Ghana almost a year ago. We still have one bar of chocolate left because we refuse to eat it. It's so good, so good. Okay, and then of course it's known for kente, the kente cloth, which technically means woven or basket, and there are many, many different patterns and many different colors depending on what you want to do. It ranges from the softest silk to the heaviest cotton, and that's what it really should be. If you buy kente now that is made in China, which is very light, it is not authentic. So I am going to show you when I'm done what I'm wearing. This is called a slitankaba. I don't know if you can see me, yes. This wrap is called duku. The top is the kaba, and the long skirt is called a slit or sleet. And of course, I'm wearing a Dutch wax, which is one of our fabrics, many different patterns as well. Okay, so I already said Kente, I want to show you, and these are all my own pictures that I took when we were recently in Ghana. There were so many, I honestly could not decide, but for the sake of time, I just chose a few. I had to show you this because Ghana is pivotal in the Atlantic slave trade, which is of course a very important part of Virginia history as well. I don't want to get into it because there's so much and I could talk for the whole day, but I want to show you this quick video. I think it's 18 seconds. This is the Cape Coast Castle. There are many, many different castles just like this, first built by the Portuguese in the late 15th century. And then they're all the way even in Latin America. Cartagena, specifically Colombia, has one that looks just like this. All of the castles are cookie cutter style. They look exactly the same. The top floor is where the governor would live. Below that is what's called the Palava Hall. Palave means to speak in Portuguese. So that's where the public would come and meet and convene. Below that would be the square where they would present slaves. Below that would be a church where they would literally be having church services, while below that in the dungeon, Africans from the West all the way down to Zimbabwe have been captured and being held in those dungeons simultaneously. All of this, everything that I just told you, is happening at the same time. So let me play this for you. It's actually my husband, our son. There's always a cannon in the Atlantic Ocean. And as I said, they all look alike, every single one of these castles. Now, there is a plaque there. Why is it? There we go. Okay, so this is the path or the opening to the male dungeon and then the female dungeon. Now, a room probably where I am would hold 200 slaves. And it's very tiny. This particular one you cannot see, but if you go in there, it would hold about 500 people for a size. Anyway, it was incredible. President Barack Obama and his family visited this exact castle in July 2009. There's a plaque there to commemorate that. So I wanted to show you that to show more positive images. This is still a very big part of Ghana and West Africa in general. There are castles like this in Senegal and Angola as well. They're now being seen as museum sites, UNESCO World Heritage Sites. I hope and pray that they stay there, even though they're a painful reminder of the past. That's exactly what they are. They're a reminder of what is never to happen again in the history of humanity. So, now I'm going to move forward to something more positive. And this is literally Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, a gold statue of him at his memorial. And this is myself, my family, my husband, our two children. And he is pointing forward, meaning always looking positively onward. And that is really how a lot of Ghanaians live in their philosophy. One of my favorite places. This is my niece. This is Kakum National Forest. There are 7 canopy bridges like this. They're suspended 350 up in the air. And while you're there, sometimes you hear monkeys, sometimes you hear elephants. This is a beautiful, beautiful escape from the hustle and bustle of Accra and Cape Coast. And it is, as you can see, an ecological sanctuary. It's beautiful. There are many, many medicinal trees there. And it's something you have to experience. And then this is the University of Legon, Ghana. This is the president's home. It's quite beautiful. Legon is a Ghana word that means on top of a hill, people on top of a hill. So the the university is situated on top of a hill in Accra. And then Ghana is very famous for its beautiful beaches. This is actually where we spent Christmas Day in my father's hometown, Pram Pram. So there were so many buildings, but this is an iconic one because it mimics the kente patterns in the Ghanaian flag colors. So this one is the yellow one or the gold one. There's the red one, and then there's a green one behind. But it's the Bellagio residence. And actually, when Beyonce was visiting Ghana at the same time we were there, they stayed in this estate. So this is us at Afrocella, which has become a very popular musical, cultural concert there. Just like there's Coachella here, there's Afrocella. All right. So when someone says to you, Akwaaba in Ghana, if it's an elderly man, you respond, Yeja. If it's an elderly woman, you respond, Yena, which is like, yes, mother. The first one is like, yes, father. And then if it's someone your age, you say, ye nya. So that's just a little bit of tree that I wanted to teach you. I know we're short on time, so let me go ahead and skip this part. Yeah, well, okay. So yes, back to TACA, the Tidewater African Cultural Alliance. I had told you our mission. We can be found on Facebook, TACA757, as well as on Instagram, the same. The website is TACA757.org. And if you have any questions, you can always email us at info@TACA757.org. And that is my presentation. Medasi. Thank you. Oh, I forgot to add one thing. For the small size that it is, Ghana has at least 80 distinct languages. And if you include the dialects, we have over 250. So now I'm finished. Thank you.
Oh, Rita, that was so wonderful. Thank you for being with us here today at Tidewater Community College for International Education Week. I do want to see if there are questions from our audience. Please feel free to unmute your mic, even if you have your cameras muted, you can feel free to unmute your mics or type in the chat if you have questions for our presenters. And presenters, if you have questions for each other, all of the presentations were so rich and dynamic.
I actually have a question. As somebody who's obviously from Africa and have seen the consequences of colonialism. So I do have a question for, and I'm sorry, I don't remember your name. If I hover it, there we go.
Leilani?
Yes. So I have a question for her as well as Dr. Toletti. How can you talk a little bit about the influence of colonialism and what the effects are today when it comes to the Philippines and then also Uruguay?
Well, I would say the influences of colonialism is very clearly the lack of identity for most of Filipinos. We are in the process of relearning our culture. We're in the process of understanding who we are. And there's a movement right now for young Filipinos, especially, to learn the Alibaba, the old alphabet or the writing. And it's sometimes, you know, if you don't know who you are, it's very difficult to have that, you know, that pride or for who you are. It's more of like you try to fit in what you're portrayed with other from other people, but you are basically, or not in terms of influences of colonization, you can see it in our food. We don't have some type of identity. It's fluid. It doesn't have very strong, like you cannot say that this is an Asian, this is Filipino. It's more of like, yeah, we got this from Spain and we got this from the Chinese traders who came here. So we don't have, I feel like we need to be able to find our originality from now. So that, I feel like that's the influence that we have, the disadvantage, the negative influence. But at the same time, you can also see, because of colonization, we are able to speak English. And for example, in Asia, where a lot of the countries in our neighboring countries, it's not their, it's difficult for them to learn English. So that affects and how migration with the Filipinos, you can see so many Filipinos all over the world, and they're able to assimilate better because they're able to speak English. And if you can see the nurses here in the Hampton Roads area, they're able to, they're very quiet group. They assimilate because they have that, I guess one of the advantages is they are able to speak the language. Thank you for asking.
Yeah, and in Uruguay, really, we are, for the most part, a result of colonization. And that's why, unfortunately, we have lost most of our indigenous blood. Right now, only 1% of indigenous blood we have in Uruguay. So those statues that I was showing you, that monument of the Charruas and the Chanás, those were the indigenous tribes. But when the Spaniards and the Portuguese came, and basically because of diseases and also because of warfare, most of those indigenous tribes disappeared. So we have very little left, but we still admire and love everything that has to do with those ancestors that unfortunately we have lost for the most part. And but yes, we are the result of colonization from Spain, from Portugal, for the most part. And then of course later on in the turn of the century, 19th century, beginning of 20th century, so much immigration from Europe. And we are, I would say, like a patchwork of different cultures. And although the Charruas and the Chanás that are our were our tribes are not there, and there's 1% of the indigenous blood, which I have a little bit of myself, left, we still have this admiration. So that's really nice that we admire our roots, although we ourselves have lost those roots. So we are a complex people with influences from all over. And some of those influences were very violent, but we are a result of all that, yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that question, Rita.
Thank you, Rita.
I have a question for you, Rita. Was Ghana ever colonized by another country? Like I noticed some African country they speak French, for example, or
yes,
like Spanish. Has Ghana been in colonized as well?
Right, and your question makes me realize that that's something that I glossed over very quickly. Maybe it was half unconsciously because I really don't like that part of our history, even though it's a very big part of our history. So everything began with the Portuguese. Pretty much they're the first Europeans that came to Africa as far as colonization. There is evidence that Europeans came to Africa as early as the 12th century. But in the name of colonization, the Portuguese initiated it in actually the very first time they came was in June. I believe it was 1415, as early as that. And they came to North Africa off the coast of Morocco, Ceuta, and they did a reconnaissance and they went back, and this was all funded, even though he never set foot himself there, by Prince Henry the Navigator. Eventually, when they did come sub-Saharan, they did come to Ghana. It was first the Portuguese, then at some point it became Swedish, then it became German, then it became Danish. We even had German and then French, and then we ended up with the British. So I just told you 8 different countries right there. The British had the most influence, and by the time, that's when everything ended with Kwame Nkrumah and the Pan-Africanists putting a stop to it and being the first to stop colonialism and creating a chain reaction with other countries. So yes, eventually it was under British control, but not always. So we, as I had said, we're surrounded by Francophone speaking African countries because they were colonized by the French, but we were colonized by Britain. And that was an interesting process because even the size of Ghana as it is today is not what Ghana used to be. And that can be said for almost all of sub-Saharan Africa as a result of colonization.
Thank you for that question, Leilani. Are there other questions? Missy, before you leave, are there resources that represent these countries that we've learned about today in the library that
yes.
you know of?
Yes, you name it, we have it. That's what we love to do. And if we don't have it, we can get it. So you can request it and we'll purchase it.
Good stuff. Are there any questions from the students that are here? Again, this recording will be made available for asynchronous viewing on our Virtual Student Center YouTube. Within the next couple of weeks, we'll make that available for you and we'll send out a link to those of you who presented so that you can share within your communities as well. If there are no other questions, are there final remarks from the presenters?
I'd just like to say, I'm so happy I was a part of this. This is highly enjoyable and informative.
I'm so glad you were able to be with us here today, Missy. And maybe we'll have some other opportunity to collaborate throughout the academic year. And we can bring you guys back with a different focus on the topic or some other area that you'd like to feature and share with our greater community.
I would like to echo what Missy said. And first of all, thank you for creating this opportunity and having us all here. I firmly, firmly believe in learning about as many cultures as possible because education is the key to almost everything in this world. If we can eradicate ignorance, then we can eradicate the consequences of such ignorance, whether it's racism, sexism, you name it. So this is wonderful. Thank you for creating this event and having such an open platform for us to share.
Thank you. And I just want to reiterate how grateful I am that you all took us back to go back and get some of this history to help us know where we're moving forward to. And I just greatly appreciate this opportunity to build and grow together.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having us.
All right, everyone.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful afternoon and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.